Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. This is a closer look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 5, Episode 20, Cost of Living. We start right off with blowing stuff up with photon torpedoes. Oh, that was an asteroid, but they didn't get the core, and it's still heading for that planet. Data said it's made of nitrium and chrondite, which are made-up things, and are torpedo-proof somehow.
It is unlikely another photon torpedo will be of any effect.
Mr. Worf, prepare a tractor beam.
Aye, sir. Captain, I am unable to get a positive lock with the tractor beam.
Oh, it's tractor beam proof too. Of course. But for some reason, the deflector cannon thing works just fine. Yay. So they are on their way, but a bunch of space litter gets all over the hull. We get Alexander and Counselor Troy's office. This is starting well. This is all typical parenting stuff. Alexander is just being a kid, and Worf is frustrated with him.
Why not simply draw up a contract, which clearly defines the duties of each family member?
You mean he tells me what he wants and I have to do it?
No, I mean you both agree to your responsibilities.
Maybe if Alexander cleans his room, he can then use the holodeck, and Worf's like, well, that is bribery. But they agree to give Troy's contract idea a try. Riker chimes in to let her know that her mom just came aboard.
Diana, my dear, it's Mother! Oh, I've got such deliciously exciting news. You're going to be absolutely thrilled. I'm getting married.
I don't know exactly how many times Loxana has been married, but it's been a lot. She wants to have the ceremony in 10 forward, and this whole wedding thing is news to Troy, and she's not exactly thrilled. Her mom is to wed some guy named Compio, and he's like a royal minister or something from the planet Costellane.
I didn't even know you'd ever been to Costellane. Or was he on some diplomatic mission to Beta Zed?
Well, neither, actually. You see, we haven't exactly met yet.
But apparently they've been chatting on Space Tinder or whatever, and their profiles are a good match. Troy thinks this is kind of dumb, and oh look, the arguing Klingons. Mrs. Troy is like, you have to give Alexander a break, he's just a kid. And this is the first time these two meet. She thinks the contract is a terrible idea.
Well, how ghastly for you. And you are doing this to your own child, Mr. Worf?
Mother?
It is Worf, madam.
Contracts are usually between people who don't really trust one another.
Okay, so it looks like Loxana is going to be undermining everything Worf and her daughter are trying to accomplish. It's the next day, and Alexander is in the counselor's office for his regular appointment because I guess he's in therapy. But Troy's not there yet. He's early because he wanted to be away before Worf got home.
I hate him. I wish my mother were here. All he cares about are rules. I'm supposed to do everything right all the time. I don't know how.
Oh, to tell you the truth, little warrior, neither do I.
Instead of waiting for the counselor like they're supposed to, Loxana takes Alexander to the holodeck. Majel Barrett talks to herself and orders up a super weird program. There's Bubble Ballhead Guy. That's actually Larry Hankin, who we'll see on Voyager, but you can't tell, and he's not even credited. There's a fire sculptor and a juggler. I figured Loxana just does lots of drugs, but this is actually a real colony on some wacky planet. Then there's this guy, and don't ask me what any of this means.
Every moment requires a purpose.
No, it doesn't.
The higher the...
Yeah, this is really weird. Troy stops by Worf's quarters, figuring that's where Alexander got to, but nope, they ask the computer and find out that both he and Troy's mom are on the holodeck. And it looks like they are taking a mud bath with a bunch of those odd characters. That acid trip floaty ball guy won't let Worf in, so he kills him, I guess, and there's a naked body paint dancer. Her name is Jennifer Richards, and she's 43 here, good for her. Loxana invites Deanna and Mr. Worf to join them, but they don't.
Mother, I'm trying to help the boy learn the value of responsibility. You're not helping by giving him a lot of mixed messages.
What is he all worried about?
Among other things, his relationship with his father.
Oh.
Troy asks her mom why she isn't busy with wedding plans. It's only 3 days away. But she says Mr. Holm is taking care of it, and Compio already sent the wedding gown, so she won't be naked at her own wedding, as is Beta Zoid tradition.
I can't believe I'm hearing this from the heir to the holy rings of Beta Zed. I think it's time to talk about this mysterious marriage to a man you've never met.
Oh, what's that? The replicator made sausage, and she ordered tea. Data and Geordi can't find anything wrong, but there have been over 200 reports of faulty replicators on the ship. Data detects a power surge somewhere, so they go to check that out. Why do they put on jumpsuits? I don't know. Oh, there's some orange slime, but first, this is the last time we see Carol Stroykin as Mr. Holm, and Alexander stops by for a visit. If that reminds you of Lurch, that's because he was. Twice.
Tell me, what brings you here to brighten my day?
I wanted to say I'm sorry if I got you in any trouble.
I really wasn't in any trouble.
Alexander asks why she's wearing that ugly dress thing, and she says, it's for her wedding, and he asks why is she getting married. So this turns into a long conversation, and I assume the point of this scene is to show us that Loxana is feeling old and doesn't want to be lonely anymore.
Then you do what we call compromise. Keeps you from being afraid.
Data says, hey, Captain, we found out why the replicators were being weird, and Geordi says, yeah, when we opened up that panel, orange goo fell out. What was that? Worf says the inertial dampeners are all wonky now, too. They drop out of warp, and Data loses helm control, except he's not at the helm. So I guess it costs too much to give Ensign Gates over there some lines. Ah, there we go. Geordi fixed it. What's going on? Well, there's that orange goo. They don't know what it is, but something is corroding certain metals in the ship into that. No, the Compio guy is about to beam aboard. There he is, and that's Tony J. You might recognize his voice because he did tons of voice acting for Disney before his death in 2006.
My dear, your compatibility profile doesn't do you justice.
Indeed, Mrs. Troy. You are even lovelier in person.
Oh, now that worked just fine.
That guy with him is Urko, and he's there to make sure they don't get too friendly before the ceremony, as per their customs. So he gets to meet the captain and his new stepdaughter, Deanna. Loxana isn't super comfortable that her future husband brought along a protocol liaison. Geordi says the only thing the replicators and stabilizers have in common is nitrium. You may have forgotten about that from the beginning of the episode because the script did until now. So whatever's going on has broken down the nitrium that already existed on the ship into some more simple compounds.
That would suggest the nitrium has been organically metabolized.
Maybe that's it, Data. If a living organism ingested the nitrium,
this residue would be the waste left behind.
Well, at least that's something. And that's bad because the dilithium chamber is vulnerable too. Worf is trying to get his kid to eat dinner, but he's doing this forced laugh thing he learned on the holodeck with Loxana. I'll spare you by not playing the audio. Alexander promised he would do this laughing thing, and all poor Worf wants for his son is to sit down and eat his dinner.
Father, the higher, the fewer.
Mr. Earlobes wants to discuss some wedding details as per protocol, but Loxana says she promised Alexander a trip to the holodeck. Compio and Urko aren't into that, but then Troy and Worf show up and they need to talk. Compio and Urko want to talk wedding, and Worf wants his kid to eat, and all Loxana and Alexander want to do is go have another mud bath.
It is essential that we begin a discussion of the wedding procedures now.
Oh, Minister Drowning, perhaps you and the Jerko here can come with us.
Loxana, this exceeds all boundaries.
So nobody is getting along, and Troy's mom's taken off. So far, the warp core is safe, but there's some magic sparkles and orange goo. Back to the weird holodeck program, and Juggler Guy is sad because he ate his balls. Alexander points out that the guy she's going to marry isn't cool like them and would never visit the mudbath program. Then, looks like that nitrium stuff is eating away at the holodeck, too.
Once we saw that photonic trail moving through the wall, we realized we must be dealing with a metal parasite of some kind.
We believe the parasites came through the ship's hull after we destroyed the asteroid near Tessin 3.
Okay, they're parasites. Picard figures that they go back to where the asteroid came from the beginning of the show, the parasites would have a natural feeding ground, so okay. Data says it will take 5 hours to get there at warp 9, so they do. But maybe the parasites on board will eat away too much before they arrive. Data says he can get them to slow down with gas or something, and losing main power, going to backups.
Commander, do you have any suggestions as to how we could encourage the parasites to leave the ship once we reach the Polaris field?
If we reconfigure a particle beam with a high concentration of nitrium,
then they would follow the beam like a trail of breadcrumbs.
Systems keep shutting down, and Worf says they dropped to warp 5.7, which is a heck of a lot slower than warp 9. Geordi says some fog machines have kicked in down in engineering, and the best he can do is warp 6. At that rate, the ship will be gone before they get to the asteroids. Life support is failing. Things are not good. People are being evacuated to decks 9 and 10, and Data says they still have over 2 hours until they get to the asteroid field.
Mr. Data, the rest of us may lose consciousness. If we do, it will be your job to execute the plan as discussed.
Aye, sir.
So here we are, and Ensign Gates and everyone but Data is knocked out. The warp core is going to go in 1 minute. Data tells the computer to use the Bessard collectors to emit a nitrium beam, but the FX guys show a stream from the saucer's ventral phaser bank. Oops. The Bessard collectors are at the front of the warp nacelles. But it works anyway, and the non-android crew wakes up. Data says everything is fine, and wow, that was easy. And this is the only captain's log of the show.
Temporary repairs to the ship have been completed. Our attention now turns to matters of a more festive nature.
Now, yeah, Loxana is supposed to marry deep voice earlobe Compio guy. 10-4 looks ready to go. There's the late Gene Roddenberry's wife, completely nude as per Betazoid custom. Riker's not sad. But Compio and Urko are beside themselves. This is not protocol. I guess that wedding didn't happen because we're at the mud baths again.
Isn't it wonderful how things worked out, Alexander?
We still have to learn how to live in the real world, Mother.
But only when necessary.
You're just supposed to sit here.
That episode was pretty ridiculous, and I'm sorry if that offends anyone who really likes it. Apparently the Nitrium plotline was added after the fact, and the director was not happy about that. And I agree with him, it was shoehorned in, but the rest of the story was just blah, so it doesn't really matter. I didn't notice this until editing, but I guess the scriptwriters don't know what the definition of parasite is, because organisms that consume metal from asteroids or wherever aren't parasites, because, you know, that's how it works. For whatever reason, the producers, including Rick Berman, were happy with this, but I would question that. This was filler, plain and simple. It focused on two, I'd say, tertiary characters, and we see Loxana many times more, but apparently this lady has a whole lot of shrooms when she creates holodeck programs. Maybe I just don't appreciate the parent-child dynamic, I don't know. I'm gonna give it 2 deltas out of 5, you let me know how you feel about that. If you liked that video, thank you, like it, subscribe, and make a comment if you want to. There's more Star Trek videos and related content on my website, check it out at kellyplanet.com. I'm Eric Kelly. Live long and prosper.